That's the most unrealistic part of this of the movie is the idea of swimming away from these super speedy, super smart sharks. You're
He
done.
was
Not
juking them
happening.
sharks like whoop, whoop. It's like, whoa, bro. You know, like
That shark would have been like, "The fuck you doing? Like, fuck this dude trying to do?"
All right, welcome to Survivor's Ed. I'm Chris.
I'm Tawny.
I'm Mouse.
And we are two blacks and a Mexican here with a special guest, Ace Cabrera.
What's up,
Ace, you
man?
want to introduce yourself from First Cut?
Yeah, what's up, guys? I'm Andres from First Cut. I have a YouTube channel there. We talk about movies, we talk about TV shows. I'm doing an anime thing now. Yeah, man, I'm super pumped to be here, man.
Excited to have you, man. This is
Yeah.
Ace has thrown one of the best movies for this show at this show. And we're super excited to talk about it. This show is all about horror movies and essentially an examination of the horror movies that we love and an examination of how our people of color do in those movies. We often will examine a movie from head to toe and then throw out a rule for survival that we learned from watching the movie and that you should learn from watching that movie. And this week, I'm super excited because this week my hat is like a shark's fin.
Oh man.
I've been wearing hats on this show for weeks, all in anticipation of
That
it.
shit is stuck in my head. Like I'm
Yep.
driving, I'm all my head is like a shark's fin, and I'm like, what is wrong with me?
That's the thing. It's an earworm. Hey, listen, it's an earworm. This week we're talking about Deep Blue Sea, the 1999 movie directed by Renny Harlan, who starring LL Cool J, who I named first. I don't know why I named him first. Thomas Jane, Samuel L. Jackson, Stellan Skarsgård.
Skarsgård.
Yeah, like a really actually amazing cast.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And this movie is it's a shark tale. It's a movie about weirdly serious kind of inciting element in that it's about trying to cure Alzheimer's and a degenerative brain disease, and turns into smart killer sharks eating people. And that's pretty much the basis of the story, right? Did I miss anything?
That's pretty much, I mean, I was just, yeah, I was reflecting, like, it's just another one of those, like, humans don't know what the fuck they're doing. Like, we're clever and we can solve problems in the moment, but we're not very good at, you know, really kind of putting out feelers and thinking about the long-term consequences of
Yeah.
fucking with sharks and
Specifically
making
sharks.
them really smart.
And
The
they.
old, yeah, the most efficient killing machine that ever evolved on Earth. Let's make them real smart.
And they should just like stop trying to cure Alzheimer's in movies. 'Cause ain't this the same thing that started the in Planet of the Apes, like the new shit? Wasn't they trying to cure Alzheimer's?
True.
Wasn't it the same thing? It's like, yo,
Yeah.
just let people lose their memory, man. 'Cause every time y'all try to do this shit, animals take over. Like, they did the same thing. Like, apes took over the other time. The sharks took over this time. Stop fucking with Alzheimer's, man. Leave that shit alone. Like, just let it, you know, let it do its thing, man.
Oh my gosh. Well, because you're the guest, Ace, I'm gonna ask you first. Like, what made you choose this movie? What is the situation with Deep Blue Sea?
I mean, I kind of told you guys beforehand, when it comes to like people of color surviving a film, there's only so much you can choose. And I didn't want to go with my favorite like movie over the past 10 years, which is Get Out, because that's a little bit more serious, a little bit more darker. I wanted to go a little bit more fun. Deep Blue Sea always stood out to me because a person of color did survive, because it was LL Cool J, and because he has like several badass moments in this movie. That stood out to me as a kid because I watched this movie. I think it's 1999. I saw this as a kid, and I saw this because my brother and my family, we were obsessed with like, well, he was obsessed with horror movies and specifically like Jaws. And this was supposed to be like the, you know, the Jaws extra Jaws.
The new Jaws.
The new Jaws. And so he, I remember us watching this movie, and I believe, check this out. This is nuts. I think this was my first R-rated movie I've ever seen. I think this was the first
Deep
one.
Blue Sea.
That's perfect, yeah.
Because it was, because we had to, I remember my brother and I had to beg our parents or ask our parents to let us watch this film because it was rated R. And we were like, it's rated R because it's sharks eating people. It's not nothing crazy, as if that made it better. But it this does. Is, yeah, it does, exactly.
The sex R is always harder to sell.
Yeah, yeah. And it's one of those things where we watched it together, and we obviously got a, you know, I got scared as a kid because I'm definitely afraid of sharks. I'm still definitely afraid of sharks. We were swimmers as a kid too, so I personally would always imagine like a shark chasing me as I swam. It terrified me. But yeah, I remember it mainly because of LL Cool J and because it was my first R-rated movie. So.
LL Cool J, he shines in this movie. But I want to comment on the R rating because, like, it earns that rating for sure. There's a moment though later in the movie where I start to, you know, like, you know how you go back and look at movies, and there's like levels to movie blood in terms of like your movie blood qualities. And there's a moment at the end of the movie, through most of the movie, the blood is like pretty legit, like in terms of, you know, what we're getting. But there's a moment right at the end where I kind of laugh because it's when, what's her name? Susan, the doctor.
Yeah.
Who I can't stand. She she cuts herself to lure the shark. And the blood that comes out looks like jelly. Oh, yeah. And I was like, whoa, what happened? What happened?
I was thinking of Miles because I remember when he said,
the open palm cut.
He's like, I ain't doing that. Like, I'm not going to cut myself open.
Stop,
like, that's
injuring
not
your hand. Not gonna happen. What is wrong with you? Like, don't injure your hand on purpose. Like,
but let me ask a question about that scene because I was just watching it again going, why did she take her clothes off? Can someone explain this to me? I don't. There's got to be a reason. I know there has to be. But my son, I was watching it with my son, and he's like, why is she taking her clothes off? I was like, I don't know. There's something about conductivity.
I don't know, but as a kid, I enjoyed that scene greatly. So I didn't really ask too many questions.
Yeah. Can I echo Miles too? Like, as a kid, that was like a very specific moment for me where I was like, oh, okay. Oh,
yep. Yep.
All right.
This is a good movie. Yes.
All right. So I sat and pondered on that scene for like a while, like a weird amount of time. And I didn't, actively like refused to Google why, because I was like, okay, the logic of the movie should tell me why she took her clothes off. I think there's something said earlier in the movie about the suits and the stuff. I think she stood on the suit because when she threw the thing in the shark's mouth, the electric current
was like rubber.
Somehow,
was it like a rubber? Like,
yeah,
a rubbery...
maybe it was because it was a rubber suit,
and so it would keep okay. her from getting electrocuted, but.
But also boobs.
Also TNA.
Obviously.
Except for the fact that, and I think, wait, what did you say? You don't like her? What is it about this actress? Like, and she's gorgeous, and I would never deny that. But I have a personal grudge against her because of the movie Circle of Friends, if you've ever seen that, when she steals Chris O'Donnell from Minnie Driver. So go watch that movie. I'm never going to be able to like that actress because of that.
The only thing that I remember her from is Troy. Like, she was the...
Troy? Oh, is she Hector's wife?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yep. I haven't seen her.
And she didn't really have too many lines, I feel like, in that movie, so...
I think she's Irish. Yeah. Well, in Circle of Friends is... I think it's an Irish movie. I don't... But, yeah, she's definitely Irish in that.
Well, I hated her in this. I'll be honest. Like, I'll just jump to it. Like, I had a hard time with her. Like, I think I liked every character in this movie except her. And I don't think, you know, it was weird because, like, you know how most movies the big rich guy is, you're not supposed to like him.
Yeah.
And I loved Samuel L. Jackson.
Fascinating move.
I was like, he's great. And I don't think I'm supposed to have a problem with him. Like,
yeah,
I couldn't tell for sure. Like, everyone hated him.
I mean, and I was it just is like, Samuel Jackson, though, like, to us. So
yeah, maybe.
I felt like I didn't really, well, I guess I understood, like, their, like, gripe with him. Specifically, LL Cool J didn't like him, like, in the
yeah,
movie.
He
like,
went hard after him.
Yeah, he went, like, in, he went in on him, like, for no reason. Like,
yeah, for no reason.
I feel like, the reason he went after him was, like a real reason outside of the movie, because he had no reason. Like, when Samuel Jackson said he didn't like working with rappers, he was like, oh, all right, okay. he's going to, like, get a shot in or something, like, because I don't even really understand his issue with him in this movie.
That's a layered question at a later point, because it's one of those things where the whole premise of this podcast, of this show for you guys, because it's like, why does LL Cool J survive? I have theories, right, where it's like, one of them is because he's the one who has faith. He believes in God, so that automatically makes him survive. But the other one is the whole, like, working man thing, where he's like, yeah, you know, he's like a blue collar guy, and Samuel Jackson's the rich guy. He's the white collar guy.
True.
I think that has something to do with it, but it's still kind of weird, where it's like, you hate him because he's the white collar guy.
It's so weird. Yeah.
Like, aggressively hate him.
It's so weird. It's like, I was writing notes. I was like, this script has so many, like, weird moments in it, and I was reading a little bit, and it's like, apparently they wanted Samuel L. Jackson for that LL Cool J role, and his agent was like, no, really? We don't want him to be that chef. So they, like, made him into this other character, which is like, he doesn't fit. Like, he's a black guy, which, like, we're typically not, like, that's not the man. And there's a fucking scene where he's like, yeah, I'm the man. And I'm like, this is weird. Like, what's going on here with this archetype? Yeah. Like, they're just, and then you throw LL in there with his fucking parrot, and it's just like, what's happening? Like, I don't know. And I was thinking about, you know, like, what Andres said about, like, the working man. And I was thinking a lot about The Thing, because I think there's kind of an interesting, parallel here, like, in the way The Thing ends. And we'll get into this, I think, maybe save this a little bit for later. But I definitely was like, oh, okay, like, there's a similar vibe there with the two survivors at the end of both of those movies.
No, I felt that too. But yeah, the... I think you're right, Andres, about the that dichotomy. But yeah, it's weirdly, like, because then Carter can't, you know, has this immediate mm-hmm. he immediately gets out of the water and takes a huge dig at him. When everybody starts leaving, they're like, it's the end of their shift, but also they hate you. Like, there was just a lot of that. We're like, let's make it super clear how much we hate him. And I guess the reason why, like, I think about, maybe it's because I'm an adult now, and, like, I work in the nonprofit space, and so I know what it's like to have funders and have funders come into your space and have to see it. And there is a little bit of, like, eye rolling, but there's not the open, like, these people are cutting your checks, so you're not, like, you're not like taking, like, very obvious digs. In fact, that happened one time at my job, and it was a whole situation, because somebody made a very offhand remark that was not nearly as direct as anybody in this movie. And we had to have a powwow about it. So, that was a little weird for me.
it's still weird though, because the whole film, I don't get it. I really don't. I try to, and I rewatched it obviously, but he's nice to everyone. He's charming to everyone. He's got a good head on his shoulders. Like, he's the one who, like, gets everyone to snap out of it. And he's like, yo, let's focus. Let's do this. Like, he's kind of like the badass of the movie. And I think that's kind of why they had fun killing him off. The directors did. But there is something to be said, right? Because I looked it up. These two, the two writers are two, I think it's a brother-sister duo from Alabama. So they're super Southern. It's really, that's my thing, is like, I don't know necessarily what they're trying to say. I don't know. Yeah, like,
but I do think it's interesting that Sam, like, is in the role that is so, it's a weird dichotomy, because you're right. Like, it's like, he's super likable, and he's a super, like, okay, so I have to point out, since we're on that the topic of him getting all this hate, I had to write this down, because... Stellan Skarsgård. Okay, so this dude is a prick. That's another one I didn't like.
Also
him
weird.
And also very just weird. Yeah. He has this weird moment where within like 2 minutes, he makes two like quippy corrections of Samuel L. Jackson. And it felt like that's a writer's thing. Cause like there's the part where Samuel Jackson says, said, what in God's name or whatever. And he's like, not God, us. And then like 2 minutes later, Samuel Jackson says, well, I'll be damned. And he's like, no, you saw what it's like not to be damned. And I'm just like, bro, so like, weird. Y'all like, why?
Y'all really, I would have just had to like call it out as something like, all right, y'all really don't like me then, okay? Because y'all just like taking every opportunity. I think it's the director just don't like me or something.
Right.
Like, everybody in the movie hate me, but they don't really have a reason to. So the director got to like just.
And then his weird fucking avalanche story that like, I'm like, what is this avalanche story?
It got dark.
Like, a random like ass. Yeah.
All, 7 of us survived, but only 5 made it out. I'm like, did you eat the other ones? Like, what happened? Like, what's the fucking story?
It never gets that. I want to see that movie of Samuel Jackson climbing the prequel. Up a mountain of 7 people and he makes it out some type of way to go.
That's a good prequel.
Yeah. Like,
that's right before he launches into his motivational speech, right? Like, he's like, 7 of us, we have to stop fighting. And I'm like, please stop standing near that fucking pool. Can we get away from the edge? Can we get away from the edge of that pool?
Carter even tells him that. He's like, dude, you might want to get away from
fucking move over. What are you doing?
I think the point of that was to kind of do a making fun of it, like a parody of the whole, like, this is the badass who survived this crazy thing that everyone knows about all over the world, but he still loses against a shark.
Yeah, it's I think like that's the point, it.
But still, it was like kind of weird.
It's so weird.
And also, like,
that's also the memorable moment, though.
It is true, but it also is kind of like you're right about the whole like anyone who says anything bad about God dies, and the one guy whose name is Preacher survives at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
I was like, wait a minute, this low-key a Christian movie?
Wait a minute.
I know, yeah.
Two Alabama Southern
with
writers.
This gigantic cross. The cross that like looks like it weighs like 5 pounds.
And that saved his life. Yeah, it saved his life. It literally saved his life.
Yeah.
I mean, that scene, we got to talk about the iconic scene of Sam getting eaten by the shark. That's literally like what everybody knows this movie for. Mm-hmm. There's many a people who have never seen this movie but know that scene, and
I feel like there's a couple of scenes like that in this movie that kind of are just you don't really expect if this is the first time you've seen him. Like even when they bite off his arm gets bitten off at the beginning, like when they're just sitting, I just didn't see it, and that's such a gruesome like scene because he's just bleeding like all over this white floor. And which like intensifies it even more, and I was like, whoa, what is happening right now?
Wait, I wrote it down. There's a part where they're like, he's hemorrhaging, and I'm like, well, no fucking shit, he's hemorrhaging. Like, his fucking arm got bit off. How's he not gonna be hemorrhaging? Kinda, do you like need to bit. Say that? He's hemorrhaging. Oh shit, really? His arm's gone.
That like, part is fucking... that part is crazy when Samuel Jackson gets eaten is, I mean, what you kind of, they're clearly setting it up. They changed the camera angle like 50 times to signal something is about to happen. But then also even when the girl, what was the other girl named? The
Jan?
Blonde girl, what was her name? Jan? When she gets eaten, I mean, which again, you also saw coming, but the shark lifting her up and like, it's like, damn, man. Like it's a couple moments in there where they go for it in this movie, which is why I like this movie so much. Like, I've never not liked this movie. Like, I saw it as a kid, and then I've seen it 75 times after that. And then I'm like, yo, I don't know how you could not like this movie. Like, like this is like
it's
the
so
perfect.
Fun.
It's so fun. Like, I don't know how you could not like it.
This movie's crazy because, like, I'm totally in when the helicopter, like, the. I when I'm watching this scene,
Stellan Skarsgård just fucking banging around.
That's what hit like, me. That's what hit. That's, I think that's the point in the movie. Like I told you, I was texting like this movie hit me in a weird way this time. And that was when it started, was when the helicopter, when he gets, Stellan Skarsgård gets pulled down, mm-hmm. and the helicopter gets dragged into the building. And that explosion goes on for like, it felt like 20 minutes. Yeah, like, where like everything's just blowing up and everything's yeah. falling down. And I'm just like, Jesus, I forgot how epic this like movie was. Because in my head, like, because you only remember certain scenes, I'm like, oh yeah, it's kind of like this claustrophobic, like hallway, sharks in hallways kind of thing, which is there. Mm-hmm. But I forgot about the massive explosions and like gruesome, crazy, you know, death. And I was just like, dang, this movie's kind of amazing. And
it kind of is.
For a movie made in 99, like,
it's pretty solid.
The effects hold up. The underwater yeah. effects, like when Thomas Jane is in that early scene where he dodges the shark and then shoots it, and it's all underwater. Like, I was like, man, like, that's kind of like, that was really actually pretty amazing how they got that shot.
It is. No, it was, that was, and that's, it's very
believable.
Cool.
Underwater believability, like, in a movie that's, you know, what, over 20 years old?
It definitely looks good. Even the scene, that scene that they, where the shark actually throws him into the glass. I think that's actually, from Jaws 3, I think. I think it's Jaws 3.
When they use Stellan Skarsgård as a battering ram?
Yeah. No. Well, it's like, it's the same shot. Like, because it's hilarious, actually, because the, obviously, it's in like 80 something. So it was like Jaws 3D. And the shark, they're in a similar sort of setting where the shark is coming towards this large window, and it's not hurling a body at them, but the shark is just sort of going directly at the glass. It looks completely horrible, like in whatever 80 something that is, but it's the same shot. And I'm just thinking about that room. Like, I have a phobia of like open water. So this movie scares the shit out of me, because open water, yeah. sharks. I mean, sharks are already terrifying to begin with. Like, and then just thinking about like being in that much water and that mm-hmm. room filling up. Oh man, like that scares me. And my other problem with that scene though is like how long they took to like assess to what was happening and get out the room. Like, you could see, which is, we all know what's about to happen. It's like, they all like sitting here like gasping.
He's like, someone tell me what that is. And I'm like, don't need to tell you what it is. Like, just run.
And see, I was giving him some leeway at that point. Like, okay, they're still trying to figure out, like, what is that? Okay, the moment it like, his body actually hits the glass, it's like, okay, get the fuck out of the room. Why are you still in the room, sitting there, analyzing and assessing what's going on? They waited literally till the glass busted before they like got out of the room. Like, what are you doing? Like, come on,
when
man.
The chunk of glass, that it looks like it weighs like 100 pounds, yeah, chunk right? of glass just yeah, pops out.
Yeah, a big chunk.
And you're like, they're still standing there like, oh my God. I'm like, the glass is breaking.
The glass is breaking.
That's your cue to run. Yeah.
Why wasn't the first thing you tried to do to get out? Like, why was that? Why did you wait for anything to happen?
I wouldn't even have witnessed that. I would have been on yeah. the other side of the door like, man, I don't know if that glass ever broke, but shit. I mean, we upstairs with
best
it down.
Play it
like,
safe.
Yeah.
There is a lot of people being cute in this movie. Like, so like, there's that. There's the, someone tell me what that is. Like, it's like, okay, just ask the question. And then like, the scene when people have died already, and Samuel Jackson is asking what's going on, asking about the sharks, and Thomas Jane is being all like, well, I don't know what they're doing. And I'm like, dude, like, like, why are we talking like this still? Why are we being
so
cagey?
There
are like,
there are so many weird dialogue beats in this movie. Like, and I was trying to mark them, and I was like, what is that? Like, there's a moment where, like Michael Rapaport, you know, our black adjacent white actor, was, like, trying to explain to Carter, like, and this and this, and then you do this, and then it, and he's like, are you sure? And he's like, who are you going to trust? And he's like, you. And I'm like, what is the point of that entire exchange? Like, was there somebody, Like, what?
It was a weird callback, but that's what it was. Because they had that exchange at the beginning where he asked that question, and he doesn't answer him. And he's all like, me. And it was a callback to that, but that exchange was kind of weird, too.
In the first place? Like, why in the first place? He's the engineer. Why wouldn't you trust him to tell you how the fucking building is laid out? Like, why would you not trust him? Oh, Michael Rappaport.
He's amazing.
He really is.
I actually love him in this movie. He's like, his reaction to the Sam Jackson death is just so, like, appropriate. Like, he's the only one who's, like, just, like, at that point, done. He just curls up on the floor and it's like, someone will come for us. It's just like, that would probably be me in that situation, no lie. Like,
I agree. I saw his reaction and I was like, yeah, I mean, that's exactly how I would react. Totally spot on. Yeah, you could also see like whose death is coming too, as far as like as soon as you met the blonde lady, literally as soon as she stuck out her hand, I was like, she's dead. She's done dead.
Her name is Jan, for Christ's sakes.
Yeah. Yes, she's gonna die. also, probably my favorite moment in the film, as much as everyone always remembers the Samuel Jackson bean eating moment. I still like the LL Cool J, "You ate my bird." And he like, you need a badass line. And for some reason, "You ate my bird" did it for me. I was like,
and
hell
he throws
yeah.
the thing like very far. I love it. Because then in like the, again, another epic explosion. And like that whole scene actually, you know, what's crazy is that as over the top a lot of this is, I was like, I was kind of like feeling the tension. You know what I mean? Like, like when he's in the oven and I was more, you know, I feel like I was more afraid in that moment than he was. Because like he still made like a quip. He said something like,
he's talking to God.
Daniel.
Right?
Yeah.
He's like, oh, the irony of cook dying in his own oven or something like that. Like he's having a good old fucking time. And he's got like a hatchet or something, right? Like, isn't he like,
I love it. He's kind of like a Bruce Willis diehard, like John McClane kind of vibe to him. And I think that was intentional, you know, like you said, I didn't even know he directed a Die Hard movie, because that felt very Die Hard.
Yeah, for sure.
I like his speech too during that oven scene where he's like, I'm like David versus the lion. I'm facing down Goliath. And he just keeps going as if he's like an actual biblical character and is writing about him. He's like, when they write my story, this is what it's going to be like.
This is what it's going
to
be.
Which is kind of like an epic thing to think that that's how you would be in that situation. You would be like, oh, this is my chance to be a badass. Versus I would be like, oh my God, I'm going to get
like Scoggs curled up on the floor, just watching yourself.
Well, that's I would be.
You know what's interesting, and I think like we were talking about. Well, I'll save this for a little bit later. But like, he is the religion piece is there, but there's also the alcohol and the random playboy that floats by, that just is like, oh, he's not like it's also he's just like a dude. He's like a, you know, like he's
still,
like a
he's still human.
But he slowly gives those things up too. Like, so that also adds to it, like, the kind of tone of, like,
if you want to survive, you can't be reading that stuff, man.
Yeah, because he throws it, like, when he's, like, walking and he has the bottle and he, like, throws it on the ground, like, all right, I'm done. Like,
fucking cooking sherry or whatever it is. Gross.
It's kind of funny how he took that as the sign, because it's, like, there's no, usually movies, the signs are, like, very clear. You know, but he just took it as a sign because everything was going bad that it had to do with him drinking.
And where did that playboy come from? Just floats by.
Somebody. Had it. Yeah. But that scene, that oven scene, for the record, like that and there's a couple other scenes like that. I think the ladder scene too. Those are really well staged set pieces. If you really think about, I mean, Miles and I have dabbled in shooting some film and stuff, and like it's hard to map out a set piece, you know, like to have it be like somebody sat down and figured out like, okay, you know, you have CGI involved, you have a practical shark, you have a CGI version of this, you have this oven thing, and I'm gonna have the chef get in the oven, the shark notices, bust the oven, he
turns
uses the
gas
a hatchet
on
to go through the top.
Yeah.
you know, as the shark enters, so that he, you know, like he made, they make the scene makes sense within the context of the movie. The most over the top thing is the throwing the match thing, the lighter thing. But, and the same with the ladder scene when the ladder falls and they're all like, they're like bait, you know, mm-hmm. dangling from the ladder. Just such a cool, like, use of human death.
Yeah. I mean, even the, like, the, that, whatever it is, that shaft, like, that they're kind of climbing up at that moment, mm-hmm. like, I'm pretty sure, like, a lot of that is CGI or whatever, especially, like, at the top. And, I mean, for 1999, like, I'm telling you, man, like, a lot of the graphics, like, really hold up, like, in
they
this
were
movie.
Decent.
Yeah, it looks solid, like, in this movie. Also, last thing I want to say about LL Cool J is, like, he, like, topped off everything with, like, the joint where he did, like, the cooking, where he's, like, talking about, like, how to make an omelet
the
or whatever.
Omelet.
Like, yo, this dude is killing this movie, man. Like, he's, like, this is like, the best part of the movie.
Who is
like,
he
easily.
Talking to in that video? Is he talking to, like, a child? Like, who is he? Who's the video for? Is that
clear?
Because he's,
I think he was just, like, listen, if I'm going to die, then I'm going to leave a video. And whoever knows me will know this
says,
is what I love. This is who I am, is a chef. I love cooking. And whoever finds this will know that this guy was here and he loved food. He loved cooking.
He says
so
something to like
thing, yeah.
about trying to be a good husband or like trying to, he says something about like, I tried my best to be a good husband. And I don't, did you say father? Like, I don't remember, but I was like, is this force? Andres, you're nodding your head. Help me out.
No, he did say those things. Yeah. I just think it's, for like Mal was saying, whoever finds it,
mm-hmm.
they could just say like, oh, this is who survived, or this is who was here, and he just happened to be the chef, and he was, you know, trying to
the
be a good guy,
parrot.
But he ended up being a good chef.
Yeah. It's almost like a black box situation, because like nobody, a lot of the other people kind of died without really having any last words or leaving anything behind. They just were killed, like they didn't really get a chance or opportunity. So he's like, yo, he really is the star of this movie. Like when you think you don't really, like at the beginning it seems like Thomas Jane's character is gonna be like, you know, the guy to save us all. And I mean, he, in a roundabout way, like he is pretty capable, you know, the whole movie.
Yeah, he handles his business.
He handles himself, but yeah. LL Cool J is like the savior of the movie, like literally.
Right. And it's this great contrast at the end, you know, of like you have, and I always think, I don't know if you've ever heard the term competence porn, but it's like the idea that Americans love the idea of somebody who's just like a badass who solves every problem. And so you have that element of like competence porn in the Thomas Jane character, Carter Blake, I think is his name.
Carter,
but then
Blake.
Ella, Carter Blake.
Name. Totally. Carter Blake.
But fucking just LL Cool J is over here with his parrot, like quipping and fucking hiding in ovens and taking out a fucking shark by himself, like as the cook in the kitchen, like completely with his own storyline. I was right, like I was taking notes and I was like, this motherfucker's still completely by himself. And it was already like an hour or 7 minutes into the movie. Like he hasn't even seen anyone yet. And I just think that's like a fascinating story structure. Like it's almost like they made this whole other section of the movie to fit this character. And that, and I was like, I read that he was supposed to die and like, and Saffron Burroughs was supposed to live and audiences were like, no.
Oh my God.
She lived.
Yeah. There's like a scene where it's like she and Carter are like making out or something after shit's blown up. And I'm like, oh yeah, good call guys. Good call on that one.
That always stood out to me. It always stood out to me that she died. Like, I don't know why. Like, your assumption is that she's going to live, right? Like, she might even be the final girl. And it's two dudes that survive at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
And they purposely kill her off in the most, like, ridiculous way they possibly can.
Yeah.
Where she clearly could have just gotten in the water, briefly put in some blood, and then jumped quickly out. But she stayed in there, like, chilling. And went super far out instead of just staying like right next to the edge.
She went like 50 yards into the water. Like, what are you doing? Like, just
weird.
Put your hand in the water a little bit. And like,
yeah, that's what I would do.
With her jello
like,
blood.
I would give it a shot. Like, right. Like maybe just a couple drops and then just like run back. But she straight up went all the way out, and then she was shocked when the shark came at her. She was like, "What?" Yeah. And I was like, "Why are you shocked? You literally went all the way out there. I thought you were sacrificing yourself." But
yeah, that's what it seemed like. It seemed like she went out there to sacrifice herself, and then she like turned Change into like mind. Will Ferrell. Like, I immediately regret this decision.
She really did. She was like, "Oh no, no." I take it back.
I was just playing.
Never mind. I'm just playing. Psych.
I mean, that's the thing. Like, okay, I got to go with my mini rant about her. Like, she's, okay, I guess it's true to her character. Because she is a stubborn character who leans into her choices. And so, like, she's the reason they're in the situation. Mm-hmm. Because she broke the law. The
Harvard compact or some bullshit.
Yeah, you know about that compact, right, Tawny?
No.
Okay. Tawny went to Harvard, so I assume that she just knows.
But I feel like they always throw that word in when they want to make something sound smart.
Harvard.
They just throw that in there.
The Harvard agreement. But yeah, so she breaks that by experimenting on the sharks, making them super smart and dangerous. She then stops Carter from killing the shark, leading to more problems. All these people are dying because of her. So throughout the movie, I'm just like, yeah, don't care. Hope she dies. Hope you die. When she had her little hero moment, you know, it was like, when she burnt up the stuff and was, you know, like, oh, I'm releasing it now. I'm like, welcome to the rest of the movie. Yeah. And then, like,
why is that shit in her fucking Foot Locker is my question. Like, it's a fucking, like, high school locker, and the fucking answer to Alzheimer's is being kept in her high school gym locker. Like, why is there not some sort of cold storage situation? I was like, why is it in there?
In a little baggie. I think in the end, like Andres said, like, she then makes this weird choice to, like, semi-sacrifice herself. And I, like, the scene is kind of like, it's probably more, you know, people kind of point out the comedic element of the Sam Jackson death now because of how sudden it happens. But to me, her death is funnier. because of that, like, oh, and then she pulls the thing and it breaks. And like, and then just to see, like, you see him jump in, and they totally, it's the movie subverting us again, because it's like, oh, he's gonna save her, and she just gets eaten brutally, and like, that's it. And I remember, like, and then they get out of the water, there's no one, she's never spoken of, like, this.
Well, I guess we're done now. Yeah, like
they have a nice laugh after they blow up the shark.
Yeah, I mean that is a good point though. Like this is one of those movies that typically there would be like the final girl type of situation, and it seems like it's gonna be her. Like when they're standing there and they have to fill up that room, and it's just those three left. And they're waiting. That scene gives me anxiety, by the way, like, because again, I just have that fear of water, and we gotta like float all the way up to the surface from down here. I'm dead. I'm not making this trip that we're about to go on. But like when they get up there, like when it's those three left, the first time I saw this movie, I'm like, okay, LL Cool J is dead. Like he's dead. He's not going to.
He appears to be dead.
He gets destroyed by that shark. I don't know how he survives that.
Oh, well, right, and there's so much fucking blood. Like, there's so much blood coming out of him. I wrote it, I was like, what the fuck is happening? And then he's fine, and she just, like, a little tourniquet on, like, over one spot in his leg. And I'm like, this guy was gushing blood in the water. And he says, I wrote it down. Like, there's a part where he says exactly this. Oh, I'm done. Brothers never make it out of situations like this. Not ever.
Yep. That was the movie being very aware of what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everybody has leg wounds at the end. Like he gets Thomas Jane has the leg wound. He has the leg wound. Like they both like stabbed up legs at the end. Yeah.
Where Thomas Jane's like, my skin's hemorrhaging. I'm like, isn't that just called bleeding? Like, what is that was weird. Right? That was my weird. Skin
like trying to sound smart.
I didn't like, know what he meant. I was
like, on because it's hemorrhaging. I'm like, that's bleeding. That's what hemorrhaging is. Like, how do you need to say your skin is hemorrhaging?
I can't lie too. Like when he like at the end of the movie, I lost it when he backflips over the shark in the in the like the underwater. He does this like a backflip as soon as he like flips over it and he catches its fin. And I was like, what? You cannot
He's
do that.
He's Aquaman. Yeah.
In my mind, I was like, is that possible? Because if it is, like, I would imagine, like, everybody thinks they're going to be, like, really cool in a situation, like, when shit goes down. But if you tried to do that, you're just pretty much going to get ate. Like, you're going to try to, like, do it. Because, like, how can you move that well in the water, like, as a person? Like, it's like, possible.
He was
like,
on some like an Aquaman.
Mm-hmm. That's like that's the most unrealistic sure. part of this of the movie is the idea of swimming away from these super speedy, super smart sharks. It's just not it's yeah. not possible. At least the you have a shot juking. If you're running against another creature, but not in the water. Like you're slow. Like Michael Rappaport's character says it. He's like, no way, a human yeah. is like two like 10 times slower than a shark. Yeah. There's no way. Yeah, as someone who spent his whole life swimming around the water, that is the one thing that I took notice Mm-mm. of in this film is like, no way, you're done.
He was not juking happening. Them sharks like, whoop, whoop. It's like, whoa, bro, you know, like
that shark would have been like, what the fuck you doing? Like,
I go to the fucking beach and I go up to my waist and I'm just getting kicked around. Yeah. By like the shitty like low
you
wave.
Start moving mega slow.
Yeah, no you know way. How uncool yeah. you look in water. Like you can't no like way. Nobody looks that cool in water. Like to the ability to where they could do a flip under the water and like evade a shark like a shark
Mako
speed.
Shark.
Like no, you know you don't look when you get in the water. Like you said, especially like me. The water is waist high. I'm falling over and shit, like slipping. Like nah, you don't look cool in the water, man.
At
Get
all.
Out of here.
Yeah, that's the one thing that I think that's kind of why these directors and these screenwriters are obsessed with writing survivor films around the water because there's a ton of them, and not just shark movies, but just any movie that deals with like surviving around this water area, the sea, the lake, whatever it is. It's because it is so many different dynamics in there. I mean, we just had a movie that came out this year. I think it was called Underwater. That's like
oh,
a survivor
yeah.
film.
I just watched that. Yeah.
But it's the idea of like. The ocean, this area is so unexplored because it's so deep, and because it's so difficult to see in there because of mm-hmm. of everything that's covering it. So, the idea of you, a human, trying to survive in an environment like that is nearly
you're
impossible.
So vulnerable, like you're yeah. so completely vulnerable. And there's a scene like the scene where Carter and Scoggs go to like do whatever the fuck. And they're underwater and they're like talking to each other. I'm like, you can't see anything underwater. Like
no,
if you have, you can't see anything.
See.
It's completely blurred. Like, how are you going to make out anyone's facial expression? Or like, you
combo.
Can't, you can't, but it happens in movies all the time. And I'm like, yes. You guys can't see. How can you see?
My favorite part of that scene is Carter going up to get air as the shark just decides to circle around for some reason. He doesn't go after him. And I'm like, the shark's right there.
Yeah.
But he's just chilling. He's circling, waiting for
he's
Carter
like,
to,
I'm gonna take a little break.
To come back. And then he starts chasing him.
He's like, I just ate. I'm going to work this off.
Exactly.
Yeah. Just do a lap around the
work off these calories. Yeah.
Well, we've kind of transitioned there. We've kind of gotten into it already. But I'm going to officially transition us into the, you good, homie? Part of our show. And can we just officially check in on our characters of color in this movie and how we think they did? Where are we at with these folks?
You know, Samuel L. Jackson's, I think the fact that he, I don't know, like, I feel like he dies, okay, but it's such a spectacular, bizarre death on so many levels that it's almost like it doesn't really count as like he just died. Like they just offed him because he was expendable. It was like a statement to kill him in that way. So I'm gonna even feel like that's not even quite a loss for our homies.
Yeah, that's a pretty like epic way to go out. Like, I mean, foolishly though, because why the hell are you standing that close to the edge? Bro? The edge. Just back up a little bit. Just back up again. Stupid to sit. Why is everybody going so far out in this movie? She went too far out when she swam out 35 yards into the water. You standing 2 inches at the edge of the dude. Back
stop. After the guy just got his arm bit off.
Dude, yeah. Take 25 steps forward, okay, and then like give you a speech. Like, what are you doing? Which I don't even know if that would have like even helped, because the shark jumped a good like. He jumped out the water pretty significantly, like, to get it. Yeah.
I think they even tease at that in the beginning, right? Where he asks how tall the gates are, and he's like, this guy can jump, like, the sharks can jump, like, over 8 feet in the air or something like that. And I was like, damn, that's ridiculous. I don't know. I'm kind of mixed on it, right? Because in a way, you could say Samuel Jackson's character, like, went out like a boss, flipping out the sharks as he was going down. But at the same time, they really... like make it a point to show you how brutal his death was, to the point that I'm like, that's kind of sus. Like, why you gotta tell us he got destroyed that bad? Why can't you just tell us that?
Yeah,
he got
they like
eaten?
Teamed up on him, didn't they?
Yeah, and I was like, that's a little extra.
What is he saying as he's dying? He's like, first we're gonna close off this pool, and then the shark fucking eats him. That's exactly what he's saying as he dies. We're gonna close off this pool. I'm like, get away from the pool.
And how was they gonna close off that pool? What in there was closing off the pool? Like, and
they have a pool cover.
Yeah, why didn't y'all just come in there and close off the pool as soon as y'all came in there? Like, that ain't even a conversation.
Well, no, because
like,
they had to debate whether they were gonna use that.
The submarine. Wait, yeah.
That was the. That was.
Oh
their
yeah,
because
the
oh,
thing.
Were gonna
oh yeah,
the
yeah,
thing.
You're right. Because yeah, yeah. There was the things they were going to take up to the surface when they got.
Because they were once again, as is the case in most of this movie, overestimating their speed in water. Because like in that same scene, this idea they were Samuel Jackson was very adamant about the idea that their only way out would be to outswim these sharks.
You think water's fast? Ice is fast. I'm like, how is ice faster than water?
It's
that
not.
Doesn't make any sense.
What is the same? Like, what? I always laughed at that. Like when he said that, it's like, you think water's fast? You should see ice. Like, I don't see how ice would be faster than water. I don't see that. And it's the same thing. Water is ice, motherfucker. Like,
it's literally frozen. It's gonna be slower.
Why would it be faster frozen? Like, yo, cut it out, man. Like, yeah.
It was funny too, because like I think what made it funny is that it was used as this sort of interrupting statement. You know, like the character says a thing. It's kind of like I can't think of what it is, but you know, there's always the thing where a character says something that makes the whole room go silent, and then they give their monologue, right? And it was weird that was the thing for him to say, is like, yeah, you think water's fast, you know,
frozen water's faster, what?
Yeah. That was a weird
depending on the circumstances, I guess. Like,
because in truth, but if we're being real, guys, like if somebody said that, you would stop and
to challenge them, like.
Yeah, but if it's Samuel Jackson, you would kind of give it a shot.
Where's he going with this?
Yeah. Just because of his presence, like, all right, I'm gonna let that slide because I don't know about what you just said, but all right.
I don't know about what you said.
I ain't 100% on that, but yeah, all right, continue. Yeah.
I think as soon as you see the movie, though, the movie opens up, you know, with Samuel Jackson's character in the helicopter heading over there. I don't know about you guys, but I immediately was like, oh, somebody saw Jurassic Park and decided to make Jurassic Park for sharks. The smart raptors is the same as the dinosaurs, too smart as the raptors.
They are,
As fast as a cheetah. Sharks move in the water super fast. The isolated island, that's the facility. That's still not, you know, done. And then he's kind of the Dr. Hammond, but he's like, you know, he dies at the end and he's not a benevolent old white man.
Yeah. He's that's a good connection. I didn't even think about that. Yeah.
It's Jurassic Park. I mean, you know, filled with his own like experiments on animals, and you're playing God, and God is the only one who can decide what is God, and you
it's
know.
A way less subtle Jurassic Park. It's like very in your face, like this is bad. It almost reminds me of people make fun of it. I still love it, but I get why people kind of tease it. It's that scene in The Dark Knight when Morgan Freeman, Lucius is sees all the sonar, and he's like, "This is wrong." And it's like, yeah. And like, that's kind of what this movie's doing. It's just like, letting you know, don't mess with nature. Yeah. It's wrong. But yeah, Samuel is the... And I never thought about the Jurassic Park parallel, because yeah, and then that Samuel Jackson dies in it, just like in Jurassic Park. Yeah.
The only thing he was missing was the cigarette, like sitting on the edge of his lip for the entire
Hold on
movie.
To your
he
butt.
Did have a cigar, I think, in this at one point, didn't you?
Did he?
Wasn't he smoking a cigar in this, I feel like, at some point? Maybe not when they went down there, but I felt like he was smoking a cigar. Like, he almost had the full get-up of, like, Jurassic Park with the cigarette, like, hanging off his lip the whole movie.
Yeah. But one of the themes of Jurassic Park is the idea, like, don't play God, right? So, mm-hmm. and the amount of times they mention God in this movie, and the amount of times they mention, like, experimenting with these sharks are smarter, kind of like we're getting what we deserved. And then the two people who survived are the blue collar, not rich, mm-hmm. not self-absorbed, kind of just worker bees who are in their world and don't really had nothing to do with like the actual experimentations with the sharks.
The decisions that led to this. It was just like, and he tells her like, you used me, right? Like, and he has a criminal record. So we have like the black chef and the white like ex-con, right?
Yep,
who are the survivors.
Mm-hmm. And that's kind of, I mean, it ties into what you were, I think you were alluding to earlier, Tawny, about the parallel with the thing.
The thing, yeah. The sort of, and that's kind of who we're left with is just who's the most like macho.
Yep. and I mean in this is like extremely biblical though, with like who is left at the end is like the most unsuspecting, like people that you would think maybe is not so deserving are the ones that survive, the like you said, the ex-criminal and you know the black guy, the chef, and the educated, like well-to-do people are the people that are like, yeah, you get killed. And it's like, this is again another, I guess, biblical allegory where man thinks that because I have wealth, because I have power, God is going to favor me, I'm going to survive, I'm intelligent, all these other things. And the reality is like, no, you could be a peasant and it doesn't matter like how much you have on this earth or how much you create on this earth. It's all about, you know, your soul or your heart or whatever the hell. But I mean, that's what ends up happening is at the end is that it's like more Bible allegory, like on top, like
it
thrown
is.
On
it's
top
a lot.
Of it. Yeah. Yeah. It's heavy. I mean, like, why is this movie heavy? Like
there's a lot of like biblical stuff in there.
Yeah.
It's the faith, you know, like that. And Thomas Jane's not religious, but you know, he has that other, you know, that other, and our other person. So we talked about Sam Jackson, our other person of color, obviously LL Cool J, does just fine, except for all the blood that he loses somehow and doesn't die when he, when he gets his fucking femur bit by a shark. Like, I don't know how that femoral artery made it, but he didn't bleed out. And he's just lying there. And what does he tell her? He's like, you know, it's the devil. And he's like, and then he like passes out or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's like,
and he
totally...
has the head. He has the head injury for like most of the movie
that
too.
Weird
where he hits
burn,
his head.
Like...
Yeah, that's right. I think another thing too is Michael Rapaport's character. I don't know why this stood out to me. Is the only one who mentioned like, hey, what about Preach? No one else.
Yeah,
he was so forgotten about.
Yeah. He's like, wait, there's still Preach.
Because it's Michael Rapaport. That's why. And the Preach, could you zip me up? They have a thing. There's a
thing.
Very
cute.
Well, because he was, if not, then Michael Rappaport would have been the only black person to survive at the end of the movie. Like, he's trying to find his other, you know, like, trying to his find homie. His other counterpart. Yeah.
No, I loved it. L survived. And just to put a button on that faith thing, like, and the first death was the character that was the most flippant towards God. Mm-hmm. Stellan Skarsgård, who, like, got wrecked.
Fucking wrecked 3 different times. Arm bit off, used as a battering ram, fucking floating corpse in the water that scares the shit out of Scoggins or whoever later. I'm just looking at this guy.
He almost gets it. I would argue he gets it worse than Sam Jackson, because, like, yeah, they arm bit off, everything. At least, like, Sam gets grabbed.
He's still alive.
He gets ripped apart. Yeah, he's still alive in the water. Like, that's terrible.
He has a long breath control, for the record, because he was down there for a while. And he was still alive when he was hitting that glass. I was like, bro, just let it go. Just drown.
Let that shit out of your mouth. Yeah, just drown, for sure.
Yeah, you guys know horror movies probably more than I do, but that's always what stands out to me, is, like, it's not who dies, it's how they die. Because if someone gets, like, brutally, like, murdered and tortured, it's usually, like, the smug businessman, or, like, the smug dude, or the quarterback, or something like that. They make it a point to point out who, because, you know, everyone dies eventually, but it's, like, the really a-hole type homies that get destroyed.
Yeah.
Which is why, like, it stood out to me, Stellan Skarsgård's character. I was like, my God, this guy's getting tortured. Yeah. Like, let him die. Like, Jesus, he just said one thing. That's it. You know, he's kind of a dick. It's not even that.
I mean,
that crazy.
That's what, and he wasn't even.
And he's
the worst.
Apparently having a thing with. Did you notice how, like, he made out or he kissed Jan?
Yeah,
she's
yeah,
like,
yeah.
He's
yeah.
the most brilliant man in the world. Yeah, and then later, and then they, like, the thing with the brain cells happens, and then they, like, totally like mac on each other for a second. And
yeah.
I'm like, oh, what? What's going on? Or should that have been built out more? Like, what's happening with this plot point? Fucking Jan.
That's the thing that's, like, ultimately satisfying about this movie is, like, it's in a lot of movies like this is where we get our kind of comeuppance, like, where we fuck up this planet so much constantly. We just do the most shit we could possibly do. And we never really, there's still doubt in people's minds because we haven't had our comeuppance yet. Like, we still pollute everything. There's still people that are still sitting here saying, like, there's no global warming, all that other stuff. And they can sit on that because nothing has happened yet. Because
to them personally.
Yeah, exactly. Because in real life, the bad guys don't always get torn apart by the shark. They live. They live until they're old, and then they regret, you know, all the shit that they did when they
maybe.
Sometimes they regret it. And they get away with it. Like, I mean, not to get political, but, like, Donald Trump, he's like Teflon Don. Like, nothing sticks to this guy. He gets away with everything. So there's something satisfying about this on top of, you know, the already allegorical stuff that they're doing. But it's like, yeah, this is what should happen in real life, like, when you're a piece of shit, but it doesn't all the time. Like, you, but a lot of times they get away with the shit. Like, they get away with destroying the earth, and it's like, yeah, you kind of root for the sharks in this, except for LL Cool J. Like, you know, like,
honestly, I don't even, yeah, for most, like, I don't really care that much for most, like, I'm sad when fucking Michael Rappaport dies. I think that's the only one that I was like, oh, yeah, that's too bad, you know? But, like, and I, like, those sharks, like, there's that part where he's like, what do they want? Like, they want the deep blue sea, and that's the fucking name of the movie. But, like, the whole point is, like, they just don't, they don't want to be in there.
True.
They want to go fucking swim around in the ocean.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that's the problem. Like, that's the whole, this is how we're still fucking up. Is, like, this, all this, these sharks fucking want is just to go.
Yeah. Yeah. But at the same time, that's what they're trying to stop at the end of the movie. Because they're afraid, like, yo, if this guy's let loose, then he's going to eat the planet. Like, straight up, like, they gotta kill him. Because it's the, I mean, it's the Jurassic World thing as far as like what happened in the last movie.
What if they just let the shark go and the shark's like, all right, peace, I'm out. Like, what the fuck does that shark want to do with any of us? Like, that shark, if I were that
he
shark.
He could rule the planet, though. He low-key could.
Just go live that's in shark. The ocean and eat right. buttloads of fish.
See, and like, but you know what? I thought about that, though, is like it getting out, like you're saying, like, what is the riddle or whatever it wants to be free. I think it's only doing what it's doing specifically to them because it wants to be free. Like, it doesn't want to be tamed. So, yeah, so theoretically, if he let him, if he gets out, wouldn't he just go, like, chill
fucking
somewhere?
Be a shark?
Like, wouldn't he just go yeah. post up and be a shark? Like,
that's this whole thing is, like, I don't know. He makes them flood the state. Like, that's what they realize at the end is they're like, this shark fucking herded us here because it wanted to get this, knock this station out so it could just go. Like, what does the shark care about us?
I took it differently. I took it more as, like, this shark now has, like, a human mind, and now he has edge of, like, evil, where now he's, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, now he's so smart that he's, like, I can play with these guys. I can get free. Once I'm free, I'm going to, like, rule this planet. I'm going to, like, wreck shop. I'm not going to... He's basically not a shark anymore because he's so smart. He's, like, another creature.
That's a good point, though, is because, like, what them doing to what they did to the shark is essentially make it not because a shark is a shark. If you get in the water, it could bite you. But this shark is doing some different, like, it's not a regular shark. So, yeah, it's possible. Like, maybe, yeah, this shark is not a shark anymore, and it's more human than it is shark, which does make it dangerous because humans fuck everything up.
Like, I think that's what they were hinting at. It's like, this is not a shark anymore.
Yo,
we
why
have to
is
stop
Deep
it?
Blue Sea trying to be like all deep and shit out here?
It's in the title, bro. In the title. Yeah. It's deepest. It's bluest.
Deeper, deepest. Bluest.
But that's the thing, right? Where it's like, if you were like, let's say this actually happened, and somebody said like, there's a, you know, 50-foot shark that has the mind of like Albert Einstein in the ocean, no one would ever step in the ocean ever again.
Right.
If you knew that was out there.
Fucking good.
Yeah, that's a good point. But at the same time, it's like,
get out.
It's kind of scary because you're just like, there's a god in the ocean who eats people.
Leviathan.
Yeah, there's like a Leviathan.
I really didn't hate the shark. Like, I really didn't hate the sharks in the movie. Like, I didn't feel, and maybe I was supposed to, but like, I didn't have the. Maybe that's just because me. Like, I'm a big weird.
I love the sharks. Like, I'm always pro nature. Yeah,
they're
I'm
well done. I mean, and I think it's well done. I really like again watching it. I was like, it's very subtle. Like, you see the shark. It looks like a shark. It doesn't look like a CGI fucking big puppet or something. Like, it looks like a fucking shark. And, like, the way it moves, and it's bigger than it should be and all this other stuff, and obviously it's a movie, but I was just like, they did not overdo the sharks, which I think is, like, a really important component of this movie. Because, like, they really could have gone the route of, like, making it, like Anaconda, right? Like, doing shit that a shark would never do, like, getting up in your face with the CGI, and that just doesn't happen. And I think, to me, like, I don't even feel like the sharks are the villain. I feel like that lady is the villain. And, like, she's the one that needs to die.
But it's crazy that they didn't recognize that in the first draft. You know? Like, if they really had her living, like, man. Because she has an arc, I guess. She does. But, like, yeah. But she caused a lot of problems. She's... You know, maybe she was the Dr. Hammond of the situation.
That's
right?
A good point. She could have been, yeah.
She's kind of the Dr. Hammond. Maybe Sam's the lawyer.
Sam's the lawyer. Yeah.
Who's there to kind of try to shut it down.
If you look back at all the Jurassic Park movies, for some weird reason, and they're still doing it now, even though it's like a different director, there's always one scene where they like purposely like torture one homie. In the first movie, it's the lawyer. In the second movie, it's the guy who wanted to, at the very end, who wanted to sell the the Jurassic Park to San Diego. Who gets like destroyed by the T-Rex.
Yeah.
And Jurassic Park 3, it happens to someone else. Yeah. It happens every movie. Yeah, Jurassic World, like they torture like a bunch of people there. And I'm
that lady though, the lady with the pterodactyls.
That one's still That one got me a little bit.
That was horrifying. Have y'all seen?
Yeah, okay. That one was a little much. Yeah, I was like,
why did they do that to her? Because she didn't even really like deserve that at all.
That was the most like, I actually was like, there's been tweets about it and stuff, but I was like, that's the most like bizarre, weird decision to torture an assistant lady.
Weirdly cruel. Yeah.
assistant lady.
I was like, that's kind of a weird choice for sure. Yeah.
Well, what are we saying here with this?
But the most recent one, they torture the guy who's trying to sell him to. So yeah, it's weird. And I'm with you. I'm with you, Tawny, on everything except for sharks. I'm sorry. I've always been afraid of sharks. So to me, I see a shark and it's the villain. Automatically.
Tawny's seen sharks. So today, Tawny's hair is like a shark's fin.
Yeah. Yeah, yep. It is like a shark. My hair is like a shark.
My hair.
Yeah.
But well, we kind of got all the way to the end without stating our rule specifically. So let's just state the rule out loud. Tawny, can you break it down?
I think what did we say in that be earthy as fuck. Like be about God, be about cooking and making omelets, be about, you know, just be about, like, be about talking
respecting
shit to the man.
Nature,
you know? Like, be about like teaching your bird to insult you. Just be fucking earthy. And Thomas Jane makes it for the same reasons, but just like a slightly different version of those, which is like it's the competence porn. He's just like a badass macho dude.
And but he's accepting LL, of mm-hmm. like when somebody pulls out that crucifix, you grab it. That's what he did. Yeah.
And I mean, he is doing the same thing. He's just not aware of it. Like LL Cool J is aware that he is someone who he believes in God, and he openly believes in God. And maybe Thomas Jane's character doesn't overtly speak about religion or anything like that, but he's definitely a pro nature type of guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
he's not really like down. Yeah, he doesn't really even seem like he's. He respects nature. He's not really down with the idea of them really experimenting on all these. He's
and he has that line where he's like, I never went to class, right?
No,
he's
like,
LL tells him, like, you weren't the sunny kid in class. He goes, I never went to class. And I'm like, oh, you never went to class. Oh.
He failed. But yeah, he's like, he is doing that. He is being one with nature, essentially, like, which allows him to do flips underwater successfully and evade
like
sharks.
Aquaman.
Yeah. So, you know, he's definitely one with nature because nobody else does that. Like, he's the only person that can. Yeah, nobody else can. Like, he even might be more one with nature than LL Cool J because he has the ability of flipping in water, you know, successfully.
He's more likely to turn into a shark than LL Cool J.
I mean, his hat is like a shark's fin. Probably more than anybody just because of his ability to maneuver in water, you know what I'm saying? Like, so song was about him.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? Because he is kind of like Chris Pratt in Jurassic World, where he's he's the shark tamer, and Chris Pratt's like the raptor tamer. It's always those guys who are like
mm-hmm. the wranglers,
nature, yeah,
because they understand this stuff. Yeah. Cool. Well, I think we did it. We broke down Deep Blue Sea. Now cue the slow beat drop in as it pans out.
LL Cool J rapping
the LL Cool J verse. Yeah, that's when
rapping
when it will
about
come in.
Every it's single weird. Thing that happened in the movie in the plot.
Like, I missed that. Missed it. Look, I missed that in movies.
That was like an old 90s thing, like where soundtracks where like. You whatever was on the soundtrack, you had to rap about specific
the
things that occurred in the movie. Like it wasn't just like now where they just take songs that are already, you know.
Well, to be fair, Eminem tried to do that with Venom a couple years ago, and it didn't
that
quite.
Was terrible.
Did he?
Venom weird. Like 35 times. Like,
do you remember the Freddy Krueger one? The he was the same hat and sweater every single day. It was so stupid.
Wait, what the hell?
There's like a Freddy Krueger rap at the end of one of those damn movies. I think it's like the...
For real?
Yeah, I swear to God.
Now, why would Freddy Krueger need a rap for? Like, why would they have that? The Ninja Turtle, the Ninja Rap, like that shit. Like
that made sense though. Like that's the kind of
the context of the movie. Yeah, like I could buy that. I don't understand why Freddy Krueger needs like a chain on the sound.
I'm gonna find the Freddy Krueger rap.
Yeah, you gotta send it. You gotta send it. Well, what you say about
his shirt is red. Like, all right, okay.
I killed children and then died in a fire. Like, whoa, whoa, now. So anyway, yeah, this was fun. This was fun. I appreciate this choice. Thanks, Ace. This is like,
this is just super fun. Thank you.
So, Ace, do you want to like let folks know where they can find you, what, where to go for more?
Of course. You can find me at my YouTube channel at First Cut on YouTube. You could also follow me on social media. I'm at Squad Leader Race on Twitter and Instagram, so you can check us out there.
All right. If you enjoyed this show, please comment, like, share. We're on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, pretty much anywhere you can find podcasts, we try to be. And also, please follow us on Instagram, 2BXM Podcasts on Instagram. We got some great content there, having some really good conversations about movies. And we will continue this series. We are tackling all kinds of movies from the completely insane, like Deep Blue Sea, to some real downers. I'm going to be honest, there's some real downers, but we had fun with it anyway. We are Two Blacks and a Mexican, and we'll see you next time.